Good morning. Oh, welcome to church on this chilly, rainy morning. We are glad to have you with us here. Welcome to Union. If you are visiting with us, I'm Reverend Sarah Relaford, the associate pastor here at Union. We are glad to have you with us, and whether you are visiting or a member, if you would fill in the attendance pads on your pew or fill out this little side piece of your bulletin, that's also the place where you can let us know about prayer concerns so that we can be in prayer with you. We have so much happening here at Union right now. This morning is a special, special service where we honor the Leaps, 20 years of the Leaps. You also have a little insert because we have so much spilled over into an insert. Tomorrow is the last day for the Pave the Way campaign for our Union Day School. You can buy a brick up until tomorrow to make a little pathway where we do, or we fundraise for our new day school. Man in the Mirror is having a new 5-week series that you are invited to. You are invited to that, Men of the Church. Walk Run for God tonight will actually be at Irmo City Park instead of behind the church. If you have questions about that, you can contact John Bowen or Sarah Reinhardt. There is an icon workshop that's going to be really neat, hosted by Reverend Taylor and Reverend Kelly Ayer. It's going to be Friday, March 4th from 6 to 9, and Saturday, March 5th, 9 to 4 p.m. It's a $45 fee, and you will be painting icons. And if you would call the church office by Tuesday to register for that, that should be a really, really good time. And lastly, you can still buy tickets for our Pancake Supper, which is this coming Tuesday. They are selling tickets out in the Narthex. Please join us for that. And then the Nikki Circle, which is our youngest UMW group of 4- and 5-year-olds, will meet today in the chapel at 4 p.m. And also, Grits, Grace, and Gratitude, the UMW brunch on Saturday, March 12th at 10 a.m. All the women of the church, whether you are in the UMW or not, are invited to this. It will be a great time. And that is all I have for y'all this morning. So let's turn our hearts to God to worship.
Thank you.
If you would be seated, our affirmation of faith today will be a special presentation of the Apostles' Creed by the Leaps.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day, he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
And let God's people say amen. Amen. So good to be with you this morning. After returning this weekend, I see my fellow travelers here. We just got back from a wonderful trip to Israel. We had great weather, great group to travel with, and I believe the Holy Spirit visited us on several occasions as we experienced some wonderful sights. But always good to be home and just get everybody back safely. Two things I want to say. First of all, I want to give thanks as today, with this presentation, we dedicate this new banner made by our banner babes in recognition of the 20 years of ministry of our Leaps of Faith. And we are so grateful for all they have done for us as we celebrate them today. And secondly, there is a video to remind us of this ministry. So let's enjoy that.
The Leaps of Faith Dance Ministry, a sisterhood, a group comprised of dedicated dancers of all ages committed to worshiping our Lord and Savior with mind, body, and spirit. Celebrating 20 years of ministering through dance, this group is based on the scripture, Psalm 149:3, beginning with, "Let them praise his name with dancing." Founded and directed by Linda Caldwell in 2002, this ministry initially began with three dancers. Within a couple of years, the group quickly expanded and branched into three different age groups consisting of all ages. The Junior Leaps of Faith, comprised of elementary age dancers, co-directed throughout the years by Lindsay Black Hatfield and Gloria Stansel. the youth consisting of dancers in 6th through 12th grade and some adults, and the adult leaps of faith. It's a beautiful experience when the multiple generations represented in these three groups have the opportunity to combine and present together. When the dancers were asked to describe in a few words what the Leaps of Faith ministry means to them, here are some of their responses.
Family.
Sisterhood.
Chaotically spiritual.
The focus of this liturgical dance program is not on how much experience one has as a dancer or who has the greater dance technique. Rather, the emphasis is on enhancing the worship experience for the congregation by bringing God's word to life and to promote spiritual emotion and enrichment for the congregation and the dancers.
The Leaps of Faith have my whole heart. I've grown alongside them in our confidence, in our performance, and in our walk with Christ. It has been an honor and a pleasure to be able to dance with them and embody the Word of Christ for others and add just another layer to our worship experience.
Throughout the years, the Leaps of Faith ministry has actively engaged with our local community to minister through dance for various conferences, community events, and fundraisers. Some of these are the annual Youth Revolution, hosted by the United Methodist South Carolina Ministries with Young People. This event consists of thousands of youth from across the state of South Carolina who gather for a weekend of worship, fellowship, and witness. Others are the United Methodist Women's Conference events, several local church Christmas programs, and various fundraising events, including Healing Guatemala Mission, Return to Zimbabwe Mission, and in addition, several Leaps of Faith dancers attend the annual United Methodist Music and Worship Arts Week held at Lake Junaluska. This dance ministry is so grateful for the love and support they continue to receive from the congregation of Union. They rejoice in the many collaborative presentations with the talented musicians of the Chancel Choir and Praise Band, and are so very thankful for the many hands who have made scarves, streamers, garments, and banners. In addition, an area church graciously donated the funds to purchase the beautiful white flags that adorn our sanctuary for special presentations from the dancers. The Leaps of Faith dancers are fun-loving spirits with joyful hearts who are dedicated to their Christian faith and are always looking to welcome additional members to this ministry. They rejoice in growing closer to God through this sisterhood, and their prayer prior to all presentations is for God to move through them so they may move others.
Will you join me?
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. I first believed. My chains are gone, as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns unending.
Will you join me in our congregational prayer this morning? Radiant Lord, you shine with grace, power, and truth. Your mercy reflects your compassion, your care, and your love. Transform us into your image as we seek to follow you. Use us to make your presence known throughout the world. In your strong name we pray, amen. Children may go to children's church at this time.
And as the children are getting out, I want to invite a new member of our staff to come forward. Thomas Walsh is starting as our youth ministry associate. We have been so blessed to have so much activity in our youth and the growth that's happening there under Eleanor's leadership that staff parish and council agreed that we could use the expertise of this young man. Thomas has worked with youth for some time. He also works IT, right?
Sales
downtown. And his wife is a nurse, so she couldn't be here today, scheduled. But you will see Thomas and Haley Walsh about our church. And so I want you to make them feel welcome as they work with youth and all of us. And before I read the scripture, this is quite a Sunday with so much going on, but I just feel that before I read the scripture and finish up this ministry series, this sermon series, I want us to take just a quiet moment as a congregation and pray for our brothers and sisters in Ukraine and all those affected by this war. So let's have a moment of silence and I'll conclude with a prayer. You came to bring peace upon the earth, but Jesus, we have ignored you. We have sought our ways instead of yours. Instead of loving our brothers and sisters, we've allowed greed and all types of things to step in.
But right now, Father, we know there are people who need strength from you, who need help from you, who need you to be present in a powerful way. And we pray, Lord, for a cessation of all this war activity and for you to bring peace once again. Have mercy, O God. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen. Today we conclude the sermon series on the long view. When there are turbulent times and when things weigh upon us, it's easy to become short-sighted, isn't it? To put one foot in front of the next. And sometimes, let's be honest, that's the only way we can get through the day when things are so tough. When life is handing us a burden that is very difficult to bear, just getting that one foot in front of the next sometimes can be a great accomplishment. But we can't live life that way. Sooner or later, we have to lift our eyes and take the long view. We have to know where we are headed, because that transforms the immediate moment. Knowing the outcome, knowing the destination, directs those day-by-day steps. In his letter to the Corinthians, that's what Paul attempts to do with this magnificent chapter that we've been studying on the resurrection. The Corinthians were beset with many problems. They were torn apart. They were not a united body. Paul says, "You are the body of Christ," but he was being hopeful when he said it. There were a lot of dissensions within that church. There was immorality. There was confusion. And Paul says, let's take the long view. Let's be reminded who we are and where we're headed and what Jesus Christ has done for us through his death and resurrection. And from that, we will move forward. So while we have covered much of it, we now come to the climax, I think, I would call it, of his argument, his statement to the Corinthians and to us. Here are the scriptures from the 15th chapter of 1 Corinthians. I begin with the 50th verse. What I am saying, brothers and sisters, is this. Flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I will tell you a mystery. We will not all die, but we will all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For this perishable body must put on imperishability. This mortal body must put on immortality. When this perishable body puts on imperishability and this mortal body puts on immortality, then the saying that is written will be fulfilled. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin. And the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved, be steadfast, immovable, always excelling in the work of the Lord, because you know that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. The Holy Scriptures for us, God's people. Thanks be to God. Death is certain. Death and taxes, right? You will die. Not something we tell ourselves when we look in the mirror every morning, I doubt. But it is a certain truth. A certain truth that we spend a lot of effort to deny. We use euphemisms. We live in a death-denying culture. If we talk about death at all, it's kind of in general and vague terms, and rarely about our own death. People don't just buy a skin moistener anymore, they purchase age-defying moisteners. Because we emphasize staying youthful and active, and we are not going to talk about aging and death. When we take our sick ones to the hospital, we now expect some amazing medical intervention that will keep death at bay, and actually seem shocked when death does arrive. It's because we are not comfortable facing the end. And yet our Christian faith gives us the language to speak of death not as an intruder, but as a welcomed and expected guest. To learn how to talk about death. About 10 years ago in Britain, a young man was dealing with this, and he spoke with his mother, who was a psychologist, and they had what some consider to be the first death cafe that popped up in England. You ever heard of a death cafe? Well, it was truly English. It was tea and crumpets and biscuits, which are cookies, and an invitation to talk about death and what it means, and were amazed at the people who showed up. And for some time, up till COVID, communities had death cafes where people would come and talk about death and their understanding of death. It didn't necessarily have to be Christian, but many did talk about death. I read about Linda Potter, the wife of a Presbyterian minister there, and why she went. She went because of personal tragedy. In 4 years, she lost an aunt to brain cancer, her father to colon cancer, and a nephew to drowning. And as she grieved these losses, she thought about her own death. And what does that mean for the way she lived? In her story, she wrote, "As we become more comfortable in talking about our death, we become more alive in our living. That's why I talk to others about dying." Kind of interesting, isn't it? As we become more comfortable talking to others about death, we become more alive in our living. Everyone's journey is different. Everyone's process of grief and loss is different. Up until COVID hit us, we had a very good grief-sharing group here, and I hope to see that return, where people could, after several losses or a single loss or whatever grief they've had, could meet and have such discussions. But one thing is certain. We each are going to die. And the second certainty that goes with that for the Christian, resurrection is a given. An unshakable victory. For death itself has been defeated by the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. So it frees us then to acknowledge that death will come because we know from the long view what the outcome will be. And you heard from the scriptures that for Paul, the resurrection is not a reanimation of this physical body. I'm not so sure I would want to carry this physical body through eternity. I've done pretty much damage to it in this one. I don't want to try again. What What is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable, he says. What is sown is the mortal. What is raised is immortal. Neither does he believe that after death our spirit somehow escape this body and fly around disembodied. No, our physical bodies die and God gives to us new spiritual bodies. After the very real death of this physical body, we are given a very real life in the spiritual body he creates for us. And this is all God's work through his Son, Jesus Christ. Christ himself has been raised from the dead. As I sat in a little grotto in the town of Magdala last week with several friends, listening to Father Kelly, who kind of guides people there, I was thinking about that truth. I thought about how Father Kelly said, you know, when the scripture says a name, like the man who carried Jesus' cross on the Via Dolorosa, Simon of Cyrene, they're not telling us that so that we'll know that name for eternity. They're telling us that because the early Christians said, oh, Simon? Yeah, we know Simon. Yeah, he's in our church. When the Gospels name somebody, it's because that person was there in the church and they knew him. People who had seen the risen Lord, people who had witnessed his ministry, his death, and his resurrection. They had no doubt. So when Paul could say, we live because he lives, there wasn't a question. Death was real, but the victory over death was just as real and continues today. You know, all your life you have been taking risk, haven't you? All your life you've learned how to take acceptable risk and when to take that ridiculous risk. But you've learned to take risk all your life. When you were an infant, you learned to take some risks as you learned to reach for things, as you learned to crawl, as you, as a toddler, learned to walk. When you learned how important it was to somehow survive when mama left the room before you were consciously aware of it, you learned risks. You learned a lot of risk as a young person, as a teenager, right? Oh, man. How about that first time you went to camp and had to sleep away from home? That was a big risk. Trying food that somebody else's mom cooked? Or how about that first date, right? Talk about a risk. You driving? You keep growing, you keep taking bigger risks. Jobs, purchases, relationships, all of life, you learn how to take risks until you come to the end of life. And for the Christian, there's no risk in that. Because Paul says, death has been defeated. Death, where's your sting? Christ has given us the victory. And all that you have learned about risk means nothing at that point. Because he has made a way. The first fruits of those who follow. At death, you simply relax into the arms of Christ. So Paul tells us, what I'm saying to you, brothers and sisters, is your flesh and blood cannot inherit what God has prepared for us. Therefore. Now, if you're a student of Paul, you will know that he uses that word very carefully. Therefore. Read the book of Romans. Read Ephesians. He'll lay out his argument. And then, like a good preacher, he says, Therefore, because of all this, therefore, my beloved, be steadfast. Be immovable in your faith and your devotion, and always, always excel in the work of the Lord, because you know that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. When you take the long view and you see the unshakable victory that Christ has accomplished through his death and resurrection, tell me what else in life is there that you need to fear? What could be as important as death and what comes after that? And that has been settled. You worried about your job? The God who loved you enough to give you life after death loves you enough to see you through that. Worried about your relationships? The God who has loved you enough to send his son to die and be raised will see you through that. Worried about your own health? Worried about so many things? Let me tell you, the God who has loved you before you were even born will love you until he draws you through death itself and to his presence. In the 3rd century, those of you who were traveling with me, we visited Caesarea on the coast, the political capital in that day, where Paul was held prisoner for over a year. About 200 years after that, Caesarea went through a famine, and then a plague hit that city. The people were starving, were dying, and many just fled. Eusebius was bishop of the church in Caesarea at that time, and he wrote one of the first histories of the church. Eusebius said, "These tragedies caused tremendous growth in our church. Because while others fled and the pagans went and hid, the Christians started carrying food to those who were starving and tended to those who were dying of the plague. And everyone saw that the Christians had no fear of death." Why? Because death has been swallowed up in victory. Death, where is your victory? Death, where is your sting? Thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen.
I dance for the scribe and the Pharisee. Let us pray. Gracious God, we sit in this sanctuary before you as a broken people, but a people who are hopeful, a people who have an unshakable confidence in the victory of our Christ. We are a people who are hurting in mind and body, Lord, but you are with us. You know these pains that rest on our heart and in our bones. You are the God who is the great physician who will heal and care for us. You are the God who is with us no matter what we are going through. Lord, for all who need your healing mercy, we ask that you grant it. For those who are scared or lonely or hurting in the face of war or trials, Lord, we ask that you surround them with your peace that knows no limits. And we ask that you hear us now, Lord, as we pray the prayer your Son taught us, the Prince of Peace. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Yeah.
for you are the beloved of God. Go with confidence. Go with the blessings of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.